couple of minutes late. You know, at the Negro College, everything is going on at the same time. So, and the AKAs are out there coming out, which means I had to navigate the whole quad to get out here in the first place. So, but I did get here in time enough to hear my friend and brother, Keto Swan, who's one of not only the country, but the world's, in fact, great young scholars in the field, not only of African diaspora history, but making those connections and linkages and to African people. So, brother, I appreciate it. And I'm glad you can swim, brother. I know you could son of the islands, because I'd have been terrified on a boat trying in the middle of the as a Negro from Tennessee that can't swim. I'm so ashamed. But for those of you who are visiting our campus, and that's probably only a handful of people, what you just saw was certainly indicative of not only the level of scholarship, but of the kind of commitment of our scholars in this space. And so to recovering the question of the African diaspora and complicating it, and of course the Porter Colloquium for many years has extended and advanced that work. Thank you so much. I'm Greg Carr. I work in the Department of African American Studies. Oh yeah, let's have a hand for those folks. For all of our people, and I appreciate the organizers asking me to introduce our panelists. And thank you, Sister Harvey. I got here, skin of my teeth. But I did get here in time to introduce one of, again, one of the country's finest scholars. This sister, who's theorizing particularly in the area of poetics and language and making connections between culture, music, language, is simply stunning, as you all will see in a minute. And that's none other than Professor Metta Duiwa-Jones from the English department here at Howard University. We stole her from several other spaces. She's the author of The Muse's Music, Jazz Poetry from the Harlem Renaissance to the Spoken Word, University of Illinois Press, 2011. I saw my man Kirk from the bookstore downstairs. He looked like he has everything black, and including DVDs, so please take all that stuff. I told him, dude, I gotta sneak back down here and see you. And Metta's book is down there, by the way, if you don't already have it. That book, by the way, received honorable mention for the MLA William Sanders Scarborough Prize. She's currently an associate professor in the Department of English at Howard University, as I said. She completed her Ph.D. at Stanford University and has received fellowships from, among other places, the Moulin Spingarn Research Center, the Rockefeller and Woodrow Wilson Foundations, and the Stanford Humanities Center, in addition to the Carter G. Woodson Institute, University of Virginia. Her current book manuscript, Mapping the Image in Black Diaspora Poetics, examines contemporary black writers' visually expressive aesthetics and black visual artists' literary engagements as forms that renovate diasporic modernism and postmodernism. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome to the podium the next voice you will hear, Metta Duiwa-Jones.
Hello, everyone, and thank you so much. I greet you coming from the English department, and I'm happy to be a part of the Porter Colloquium today. I am, and thank you for that introduction, Dr. Carr. I am not going to be presenting from my current work, Mapping the Poetic Image, since I was asked to present on literature and the Black Arts Movement. So you'll bear with me. There will not be slides. This is going to be a roll call of literary output, and you'll hear overtures to artistic output, but there will be a lot of poetry, which I was asked to bring, since poetry are part of the roots. I'm going to start my talk. The title of it is Medallions of the Movement, Poetry, Jazz, and the Beautiful Within and Beyond Black Arts Literature. I'll begin with a quote from the contemporary poet Ruth Forman in her poem Renaissance, in which she says, "I say, who will name this Renaissance I stand knee deep in? Who go tug the elbow of Langston Hughes? Tell him we are yesterday again to McKay and Cullen and Hurston and Walker and Baldwin. We doing it again. I say, who look at the chorus singing up old times and new warnings? Who hear the griot staff scratching maps and instructions? Who hear the constellations warp speed within our nappy heads? Who listen to twisted tongues trying to tell it, man, tell it? Who name the round and square faces? Who record the close? Who record our applause, our sigh, our eyes close and nod? Who record a jump up of the spirit, a amen, a well? Who record a whisper that's all right, a holler and a moan? Who record our smile or chuckle, our uncomfortable shift? Who will record the music? I begin with Foreman's profusion of oral inflection and the iterated tell it now, tell it who will tell it, amen and well, in part to give a focus on how much my emphasis on African-American-influenced Black arts literature emerges not only within the literary, but within the musical dimensions of that and within the diasporic. Quote, an African song in American English. The poet Lorenzo Thomas applied this twin-tongued phrase with its metaphor for diasporic music on the one hand and localized language on the other to A.B. Spellman's book, The Beautiful Days. Spellman wrote the book while he was also working as a freelance writer and jazz reviewer. Poems such as Did John's Music Kill Him, which include the line, Oh John, death will not contain you, reflected the resurrecting spirit in the subgenre of Coltrane poems, and a little bit later I will perform one of those poems, that flourished in the wake of the saxophonist's death in 1967 during the crux of Black nationalism and Black power. In Spellman's pithy phrasing, quote, Train's horn had words in it. Those figurative notes, when translated, became, quote, saturated, end quote, with a massive concentration of Black cultural and textual experience. And that quote's not from Spellman here, but from our own Howard University's Howard University's late Stephen E. Henderson, who also coined the word mascon for massive concentration of Black experiential matter, and talking about the evidence of Black arts and Black diasporic Africanist presence in literature of the Black arts movement. For Henderson and many writers and musicians of the era, jazz was also a word, a phrase, a rhythm, so right, so Black. And if jazz was the secular religion of many members of the Black arts movement, then John Coltrane was the movement's patron saint. Jazz, so right, so rebellious. The formation in the early 1970s of the St. John Coltrane African Orthodox Church in San Francisco amply manifested a sacred dimension of Black cultural institutions that developed in secular arenas as well throughout the country. As the poet and painter Clarence Major observed, quote, Black schools of vital poets who were reaching the peak of artistic fertility displayed evidence of Black arts movement spreading from Harlem to the West Coast. As the editor of the New Black Poetry in 1969, Major featured writings that showcased experimental departures from traditional Western forms and aesthetics by authors such as the poet Russell Atkins, the poet Julia Fields, Audre Lorde, who people are more familiar with, Quincy True, and then practicing as a poet, but now more well-known as a novelist, Ishmael Reed. Reed, however, strictly declared his differences from Black arts movement philosophy. Even though he appeared in many albums, such as kind of the Black arts poets, new jazz poets, and so forth. He, like many poets and writers of the era, was galvanized by an increased racial and sociopolitical consciousness, despite his disaffiliation with Black arts and Black aesthetic ideals. My talk is trying to illuminate how music literature and then correspondingly is in conversation with visual art and its critical institutions that served as highly valued medallions during Black arts and Black power movements. Jazz was less like the golden child of the Black arts movement and more like its rebellious teenager, contrary to popular belief. Writers interpreted the developments in the, quote, new music and experience with free jazz, for example, think of Coltrane and Archie Shepp's collaboration on the album New Thing and New Port, and so much of the emphasis on the new, even though, as I think we heard with Kito Swan's talk, that emphasis on the new Black, the new Black thing, the new Black aesthetics, is deeply, deeply rooted in old and older and even ancient Africanist practices. This new thing at Newport included sonic protests that furthered Black nationalist revolution. Avant-garde jazz during the 60s and early 70s, played by Ornette Coleman and Albert Ayler, and the pianist and poet, interestingly, often underappreciated as a poet, but later anthologies included the jazz pianist Cecil Taylor's poems in anthologies such as the Jazz Poetry Anthology and Second Set New Jazz Poetry. Sun Ra and among others were all seen as models for poetic experimentation in the service of the liberation struggle.
The departure in free jazz from straight-ahead jazz conventions, such as creating improvisations without preset chord progressions, serves as an impetus for and converged with the radical transformations of free verse forms in Black poetry, in spelling, in grammar, in lineation, in content, right? These are kind of the provinces of a literary professor. Often when I teach Black Arts Movement poetry, my students don't encounter it as being particularly radical. And so sometimes it's important to kind of emphasize that in the 60s and 70s, at that time period, the kinds of page-based and oral experimentations that were taking place were major breaks from the way that poetry, or what was constituted as poetry, held sway at the time. Some of the affiliates, for example, of the Umber Workshop, a proto-Black arts writing collective, created concrete poems that were African-centered in vision and form. The poet Norman Pritchard, for instance, in his sound poem, Jars Galax, continually reiterates the lines, variegated sound through beneath lit dark. Now, when you first hear that, that doesn't sound particularly, sounds pretty bland. Variegated sound through beneath lit dark. But in Pritchard's rendering, he continued to kind of alter that particular line, variegated sound through beneath dark to through beneath, above beneath, above beneath, lit dark and lit dark, viewly and lit dark, viewly and lit, above beneath, above beneath, lit. So he does a lot of kind of jazzing of the line, varying pitch, tone, and word order so that the linguistic alteration ambiguity for him reflected a sense of the changing same, the continuum of African-American vernacular expressive arts with diasporic African culture so celebrated during the period and even to today. The pianist and composer Randy Weston's Uhuru Africa, Freedom Africa, with lyrics and liner notes by Langston Hughes, someone who's often not thought of as a part of the roots of Black Arts Movement literature, but who continued up until his death, you know, with The Panther and the Lash, actually being someone who sponsored and engaged both. He published and was in conversation with Amiri Baraka. So contrary to the kind of traditional presentation of this radical break between the Harlem Renaissance and the Black Arts Movement in terms of literary roots of the period, there was much more continuity than is often presupposed. We insist Mac Roach's Freedom Now suite with Coleman Hawkins, Olatunji, and Abby Lincoln, featuring tunes such as All Africa and Tears for Johannesburgs, and Coltrane's Kuluse Mama, all reflected Black artists' attempts to merge anti-colonial, anti-imperial, and anti-apartheid apartheid political perspectives with musical visions that expanded African music's percussive and harmonic influence. The music. Black Renaissance history, Black arts maturity. The Negritude, New Negro Renaissance, and Pan-African movements illustrate that this was not the first time that music, art, and culture would be employed by Black arts artists and intellectuals to affirm the race, quote unquote, despite the global dehumanizing of Black people from slavery onwards. For instance, blues music with its repetitive AAB tercets or AABA quatrains became the idealized prototype for innovative sociopolitical critique by poets such as Hughes in The Weary Blues. Four generations later, Baraka, after he had transformed from Leroy Jones, our Umamu spiritual leader, would identify blues as, quote, the slave citizens' music, end quote, and jazz as its parallel modern form, a musical form for the development of a historically informed racial and class consciousness. As Baraka recalled in Blues People, it was, quote, and here I always like to emphasize this with my students, it was here at Howard University that Baraka said, quote, Sterling Brown, the great African-American poet and his English professor here, who first hipped A.B. Spellman and me, and this is Baraka speaking, to the fact that music was our history, end quote. The musical and literary historical context frames Lorenzo Thomas's declaration that, quote, one might begin studying the literature of the Black Arts Movement by examining Spellman's poetry collection, which displayed, quote, Black art in full maturity and strength. The Beautiful Days was published in 1965, the same year of Malcolm X's assassination, the same year that the Voting Rights Act was passed into law, outlawing literacy tests and other hindrances to Black enfranchisement, the same year that Baraka founded the Black Arts Repertory Theater in school, often identified as the Black Arts Movement's formal beginnings, the same year that the Black Visual Artists and Collective Spiral, those people in the audience at the Porter Colloquium would be familiar with, whose members included Bearden, Emma Amos, Hal Woodruff, and hosted the first and only Works in Black and White group exhibit, the collective symbolically restricting that palette to the black-white binary at the Christopher Street Gallery in New York. Focusing on multiple artistic mediums better reflects the cross currents and dialogues that occurred within the literary, musical, and visual culture during the 60s and beyond. Each art form offered its own unique expressive force, vital to illuminating Black aesthetic ideals. One such ideal was the freedom to define that emerged both within an Africanist and an Americanist sensibility, standards for artistic and cultural excellence. Another equally crucial ideal was to restore to health the psychic and physical lives of African Americans. And the psychic dimension of Black arts movement literature, not just its aesthetic dimensions, is something that I think is worth undercurrent, because it's often that psychic dimension that I would argue serves as roots for connection and dialogue with the visual art. As James Baldwin noted, quote, "The American triumph, in which the American tragedy has always been implicit, was to make Black people despise themselves," end quote. To foil that ambition, Black power advocates harness the expressive energies of the beautiful. The meaning of beautiful, bountiful Black writing cannot, therefore, be underestimated. The meaning of beautiful, bountiful Black writing, in the face of the efforts that Baldwin speaks of to make Black people despise themselves, cannot be underestimated. The 60s, therefore, were not a time when the word beautiful was not just a, and Black is beautiful was not just a descriptive slogan, right? Or a modifier for people, places, or things. Ornette Coleman offered listeners an earful on the beautiful when he recorded the tune "Beauty is a Rare Thing" for the album "This Is Our Music" in 61. Beauty as a Black theme was also a theme permeating these social and political spheres. Black is beautiful wasn't just a slogan, this powerful political expression resisting anti-Black racism. It was an affirmation embracing the oft-disparaged Black body, the title of several books, one by the Chicago poet and activist Eugenie Eugene Perkins, published by the Free Black Press, and a rhetorical challenge to centuries of the gross deformation of African Americans' visage and culture. Writers specifically wrestled with the slogan's transformative potential, as well, and hear me carefully here, as its limitations. As the iconic Black arts movement poet Sonia Sanchez queried a few years later in We Are Bad People in 1970, and I'm quoting Sanchez here, "Who's gonna take the words Black, beautiful, and make more of it than Black capitalism?" The relevance and the tendency for radical Black expression during the Black arts movement to become co-opted and commodified is something that I think that's important in thinking about the nature of literature and its roots in the Black arts movement. But poet and essayist Sarah Webster Fabio of that period promptly responded to Sanchez's symbolic question and challenge with an apposite answer, Black wordsmiths, and I'm quoting Fabio here. "Black writers, most of them poets plus, have always been barometers, even when America kept bell jars on them," end quote. In Tripping with Black Writing, Fabio published, which was published in Addison Gale's landmark literary connection, The Black Aesthetic in 1971, the move toward liberation from slave to serf to self for Black folk has been a long, arduous trip. And part of the trip and the importance of citing literary roots such as Gale's anthology is that there was not one Black literary aesthetic during the Black arts movement, but Black aesthetics, plural. And that's crucial in terms of later reevaluations of the movement. I think I see Lisa Gale Collins here and Margaret Carford, who's going to be your keynote speaker a little bit later during the colloquium, who in their revisit of Black arts movement, literature and visual art, looked at the more diverse kind of approaches to Black aesthetic political thought during the period, as opposed to the kind of stereotype of Black arts and Black arts movement literature as a monolithic hold that codified ideal notions of what it meant to write Black or speak Black or talk Black or perform Blackness within literary modes. The journey, Fabio argues, this quote-unquote Black experience has been chronicled in the annals of Black literature. Some of the creative and critical chronicles of this voyage included, and here I'm going to do a roll call because I was asked to kind of really bring forward literary roots of the movement, so you hear me as I just read several of the artists and titles in fashion that are part and parcel of the movement. Jane Cortez, Pistane Stairs and the Monkeys, Man's Wares in 1969. Jane Cortez, Mouth on Paper, followed up with 1977, as those in the audience who know her collaborations with the visual artist Mel Edwards. Nikki Giovanni's Black Feeling, Black Talk in 1967. And the one that's more often cited by my students is Cotton Candy on a Rainy Day. I don't know if it's the title, seems a little, it's something about the title instead. Michael Harper's Dear John, Dear Coltrane. I mentioned Coltrane earlier, of course. And his Images of Ken in 1977. Willie Kotsitsile, Spirits Unchained in 1969. I'll return to him in just a minute. The present is a dangerous space to live. Audre Lorde, The First Cities, The Black Unicorn in 1978. Larry Neal's Black Boogaloo, Notes on Black Oration, and Hoodoo Hollerin' Bebop Ghosts. Carolyn Rogers, Blackbird in a Cage, The Heart is Evergreen, and of course, Entozake Shange's For Color Girls, but less frequently noted Nappy Edges. This list reflects only the writer's earliest and latest poetry collections published specifically within the time frame of the Black Arts Movement. Notably, for my purposes, I want to kind of underscore how much each artist published additional volumes in the period, all continued prolific careers, working across multiple genres well into the present day. So many Black poets, playwrights, essayists, and anthologists published work during this era, thus that it makes sense that Larry Neal would call the Black Arts Movement, quote, the twin sister spirit of the Black Power and Freedom Movement. The list could easily expand exponentially in the interest of time. I'm not gonna continue the roll call. And still not account for all the writers in the 60s and 70s who actively sought to reframe racialized aesthetics and to transform white washed America's alienation of African descended peoples, artistic and cultural production locally and globally. I'm going to move to talk about why I chose the phrase medallion towards my conclusion instead of the more political term manifesto. And then I'm going to read a contemporary post-soul Coltrane poem that is a kind of a legacy of Black Arts Movement poetry that focused on Coltrane. Medallion is jewelry. The medallion is a decorative and ornamental pendant. As such, it encapsulates the idea of arts for art's sake as mere adornment that was especially eschewed in favor of art for all our sakes, harnessed the political agenda for Black liberation. As Ron Karenger avowed, Black survival, all art must, for Black for survival, our art must reflect and support such revolution. Medallion is an emblem. A medallion is a visible symbol or a tactile representation of abstract ideas. Through reviews and other forms of critical dialogue, theorists of Black aesthetics delineated how individual poems, plays, and musical performances and artistic works represented and enacted their philosophies. In fact, which is relevant for the Porter Colloquium, so much debate occurred over which artistic medium, right, could most capably convey the militant zeal of Black self-determination, affirmation, or self-affirmation. On the one hand, you could hear Larry Neal proclaiming in one ear, quote, drama is the best realization of the Black aesthetic because it shows the Black person, quote, in transition. On the other hand, you would hear the affirmation poet Clarence Major lamenting that, quote, nobody has told America more eloquently than Black poets how it can save itself, but America is deaf. I'm going to end not with a deafening, but a sounding of a post-Coltrane Coltrane poem that is a part of the legacy of the Black Arts Movement, since I was asked to kind of not only emphasize the Black Arts Movement's literary roots, but also to give a sense of its contemporary legacy. And the title of this poem is Post-Soul Train. Scream! A screech, a squeal, a shriek, a squawk, a sutter, a sob, a hootin', a hollerin', a honkin'. A moan and groan, a mule and howl, a yell, a yawp, a yawn, a yawn, a sound, a sheet, a sound, a well sound, a welling sound, a weltering sound. Ah! Tapestry and sound. Ah! Torrent of sound. Ah! Aggressive sound. Ah! Serene sound. A repetitive meditative mantra. Ah! Amazing and amusing sound. Amazing sound. A terrible, 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 terrible. Sweet back, sweet black clarinet, tenor, soprano sound. An altered alto, alto sound. An ill Eldell Philadelphia sound. An R&B commercial break. A walk in the bar and blues. A bridge to spiritual sound. A gospel round. A hymnal, a heart bop, a harp. A blues, find a rhythm and cruise. Sound, an upheaval sound. A cerebral sound. A homegrown sound. Uproot sound. A grassroots trip. Tripper feeling tight, taut, tight like that sound. A waltz. A seven steps to heaven sound. A heaven sent. A freedom song. A free jazz sound. A run, a riff, a running around and around sound. A two plus two equals four, four, the classic quartet sound. A two and two and two and two and two and two and two. Much too long sound. A loud, cunning, strong sound. A walk in the bar. A hymnal, a heart bark, a heart. A calm, modal, cool sound. A warm, warning, hot sound. A saint sync a universal sound, a universal sound, a vibratilist sound. The vibration resounds, the sound of jazz, the sound of black power, the sound of anti-jazz, the sound of anti-colonialism. This Coltrane was his sound, this Coltrane song, this Coltrane psalm, Coltrane psalm is song, Coltrane song is soul, post-classic soul surrounds Coltrane's quartet sound, telepathic. Thank you. Okay. Okay,
it else? Oh. Yeah, I just think the publishing apparatus that was developed in the time, particularly, I'm thinking about Third World Press and Hakeem Olajuwon.
Oh, sure. In a longer version of the talk, I talk about there. I alluded to institutions. There's a line in the talk where I talked about cultural institutions. So, in a longer version of the talk, I actually talk about presses. And so, not only is there kind of Donnelly's Third World Press, but also Dudley Randall's Broadside Press, right? And so, what's significant about both of those as publishing institutions, and if you will, I'll fold it into the kind of keyword I use as medallions, right? Is that far from just thinking in terms of like artistic adornment, right, or something that's decorative, the presses were fundamental to kind of that level of literary output. And in fact, something that's useful for students, I think, and scholars today to think about is the fact that the cost of printing paper, right, and what those affected the ability for Madhubuti's press and even Dudley Randall with his press and even Naomi Long Maget, right, with Lotus Press to be able to publish in huge, I mean, thousands and thousands of copies, several of the artists that you heard me when I did my roll call list, their books, right? The other thing is that also meant that they were kind of able to quickly distribute them. In today's time, sometimes when I'm teaching, I talk to students, a student asked me this morning in my class earlier, so I couldn't come to the morning session. Well, was it like in today's time where students sometimes go to poetry readings and we ask them to show up and they bring their laptops or iPads and take a few notes just to kind of get their grade or was it that people were really galvanized? And so then I showed some documentary clips to say, listen, it might be hard for you to imagine unless you go to like a poetry slam or something, but even in university spaces, it is precisely kind of the press's ability, the volume and spread of Black arts, the literature, in terms of sheer numbers. There was much more, I would argue, in that period of time within those settings, a mass sense. Everybody wanted to be a poet, right? You even had like the jazz musicians. Mingus is carrying a book of poems in his back pocket on the way to a jam session in a way that in today's time, I wouldn't say if we think about, let's say, contemporary bassist Christian McBride, you would ask him, he's not like carrying, let's say, a copy of Claudia Rankine's Citizen, though he should, right? I mean, I would argue. So I think that, does that help speak to your question? Okay. Yes.
This is kind of a personal question.
Sure.
Grandson, 7 years old, wrote a remarkable poem.
Okay.
But he doesn't like people to know that he does this.
Mm-hmm.
So how can you encourage someone to expand in this? You know he enjoys it,
mm-hmm.
but he's almost afraid to say that he does it.
Mm-hmm. Well, this actually relates very much to the topic of Black arts literature and the roots in a way. You said it's personal, but I can make it both personal and professional. So one of the things that we think about in my talk when I talk about the sacred and the secular, there's a moment I was talking about that. In your generation, right, and in earlier generations, if you'll allow me to allude to your seasoned nature, the sacred dimensions of various kind of Black churches meant that at 7 years old, your loved one had the opportunity to go and do recitals, right? If you think about like in the early 20th, even up to the 50th, up to the 50s and 60s, I even did it. I date myself where they were like, you recited Paul Laurence Dunbar by rote, right? So you had this exposure, whether or not, right? So you wanted it. Sometimes in your case, it sounds like your loved one, he desires it, but there's this sense of kind of claiming the idea of poet or claiming that identity and him not wanting to share it in a contemporary moment where that has been kind of lost may mean that if he's writing poetry, but he doesn't necessarily identify, let's say, with a hip hop artist, he's writing more kind of writerly poetry, he may not want to share it because he may think like, oh, at that age, this doesn't make me seem cool or something. I'm not sure what his concerns are, but you asked how would you encourage. And so to make sure I directly answer that question, one of the things I would say, give me his name, I'll have him come read for my poetry class. I'm teaching poetry across cultures this semester. I'm very serious about that. But the other thing I would say, have him read around his family, his friends, right, first. Like, encourage him in smaller communities and then build beyond that so that he develops the kind of confidence that further underscores it, that to create, right, that urge, that will to create that's coming in him is, he's already taken the brave step to write, right? That it's just only a half step to go a bit further to share it with the world, right? And that's not only his right and his privilege, but his responsibility, right? From your family lineage and from being given the gift to write, right? Does that? Okay, great. All righty.